Part 9 of Beyond Good and Evil begins with sections 257 and 258, in which Nietzsche describes the importance and function of aristocracy in the spiritual advance of humanity. All advances in human culture, writes Nietzsche, have been led by aristocratic societies. Spiritual evolution requires a strong order of rank, a key concept in Nietzsche's thought. He explains how the social and the spiritual are linked. The pathos of distance between higher and lower ranks of men, constantly reinforced by practices that keep the noble self aloof and keep the lower orders down, this pathos leads to a similar elevation in the soul. The social and psychological institutions of aristocracy power the human drive to self-overcoming, or self-transcendence. Nietzsche ends this section by dispelling any romantic illusions his readers may have. Aristocratic cultures always begin in violence and subjugation. Barbarians, strong but crude in both culture and spirit, sweep down on peaceful, weak, corrupt, more civilized peoples. But their dominance is not merely physical, but spiritual. They are more fully human in every sense of the word, and thus also more fully beasts. Section 258 describes the conditions of healthy and corrupt aristocracies. For an example of a corrupt aristocracy, Nietzsche cites the nobility of pre-revolutionary France. They threw away their privileges in order to indulge their moral vanity. This was the final act in their centuries-long abasement before the monarchy. By contrast, writes Nietzsche, a healthy aristocracy sees itself not as a function or partner of any other social institution, but rather as the meaning and justification of all other classes and institutions. Thus, a healthy noble class accepts that countless other human beings must, for its sake, be lowered to the status of incomplete human beings, not fully human. They have a fundamental faith that society and other humans exist for them, not they for it. Nietzsche compares them to the sun-seeking vines of Java, which grow up around the tallest trees until they reach the canopy and can unfold their glory in the sun. Here Nietzsche seems to be describing a corporate will to power, the confident strength of will of a noble class to dominate weaker elements in society and to accept the human suffering that domination entails without self-doubt or rational qualms. Let me pose three questions about Nietzsche's claims in these sections. First, a historical question. Is his account of the origin and advance of human societies accurate? Do societies in fact advance through the domination of barbarian conquerors? Second, is Nietzsche justified in extending this historical observation into human psychology? Is social order of rank a necessary condition for the advance of the higher parts of the human spirit? Third, does acceptance of the human costs of one's social order indicate a strong spirit? Is Nietzsche right to suggest that second thoughts and humanitarian qualms are a source of corruption and weakness? That's my summary of and commentary on sections 257 and 258 of Beyond Good and Evil. Thanks for watching today. Goodbye.